three, they surprise no one.
Yep, it's 6:45 in Singapore, and we're about to prepare for our interview with David Steary.
Hi, everyone. I hope you're staying safe. My name is Fire. I'm the founder and CEO of Soundfire, a global home for musicians, talents, music professionals, anyone in the music industry. And if you want to discover music, we are the platform and community. So today, we will be interviewing David Steary from Real Life, the man that brought you the hit, the mega hit, Send Me an Angel, right here on the Mob Squad.
Send me an angel. Send me an angel.
Hi, this is David Steary from Real Life, and you're listening to Soundfire, My Life and My Music.
Mob Squad.
So our interviews.
Ladies and gentlemen, people of the universe, I would like to introduce an old buddy of mine. We've lost contact and we're back, thank God, to Zoom. He is none other than, I'm still in shock here because I've never seen you or communicated with you for so many years. And now with technology and all that, ladies and gentlemen, people of the universe, please welcome on Soundfire's Mob Squad, David Steary from the band Real Life, all the way from Melbourne, Australia. Welcome, David.
Good morning. Hello. Whatever time it is, wherever you are, hello. And it's lovely to be here and great to see you again, my friend.
How did it start for you in the music career? You know, what made you decide to jump into music? Tell us more about that.
I can't remember.
Really?
No. Look, I grew up loving music. I remember being a very little boy, being about... maybe 6 or 7 years old and sitting at home on the floor, and my mum had the radio on and I heard a group called the Beatles singing She Loves You, Yeah, Yeah, Yeah.
Okay.
And, I went, ah, wow. And it's like I immediately knew what a hit song was. A hit song was something that you can't get out of your head. You know, it becomes a hit song. If you can't get it out of your head, it's what is a hit song. And, I went to school, and in high school, I realized that I was pretty ugly, and the only way I was ever going to get a girlfriend was to join a band, be a musician.
Really? Are you sure that's a real reason, David?
Well, that's partly, yeah, because it does work, and there's many, many musicians will say that. You know, I was
rock and roll, man. Rock and roll.
I was lousy at sport. I wasn't very smart in school. Okay. I didn't know what I was going to do, but I did love music. Yeah, so I was having some guitar lessons throughout my early teens. And then one day at lunchtime at high school, a teacher came around. We were having the school fete fundraiser thing going on. And he came up to me and he said, Steary, I've heard you've been taking guitar lessons. And he had another guy, Fulvio, I hear you're a singer. Tony, you're a bit of a drummer. Graham, I hear you're playing the bass. Right, you've got 2 weeks to form a band and play at the school fete. And we went, but we can't, but we did. And so that was my first ever band, was at high school. And it was just so exciting to be on a stage and playing music with other people. You know, it's loud and it's fantastic. You know, it's so much fun. So, you know, I was addicted, and I didn't think I was going to get very far. You know, I'm not looking for compliments here, but I'm not a great musician. I'm not a great singer. I'm not a great songwriter. I have to work very hard at what I do. And I never thought that I would get anywhere, because I had so many friends around me who were better musicians than me, and, you know, far more smarter songwriters and things. And I was at a real loose end in my life in my mid-20s, and I got an opportunity to start a band called Real Life with a guy called Richard, who was the keyboard player.
Okay.
And even then, you know, Send Me an Angel became a hit when I was about 29 years old, really. And if you had said to me when I was 27, hey, you're going to be an international rock star in 2 years, I would have said, no way. No way, no Whoa. Way, no way. So I look back and I'm just, you know, really grateful. There's been, you know, the music business is full of rough times as well. I've had probably more bad times than I've had good times.
Yeah.
And I'm very grateful for the life I've had. And as I'm getting, you know, I'm into my last, you know, it's in the winter years of my life. I realized that, you know, for the last 40 years, I've been in a band called Real Life, and music is not a waste of a life. Making music, whether you're successful or not, is not a waste of your life. Does that answer your question?
That is very good. That's a very good answer. But and the next thing here is, how did you come up with the name Real Life? Where did that come from?
I don't even like it. We were called A Private Life.
Oh, okay.
And we were from Melbourne, which is in Victoria, the state of Victoria. And, you know, when you're doing well in Melbourne, you've got to look at going to Sydney and New South Wales to go and start breaking that market as well.
Okay.
And there was a band in Sydney called Private Lives who heard we were coming up and said, if you come up and call yourself A Private Life, we'll sue you.
Okay. So, oh, really?
Yeah. So we had to change our name, and they ended up going nowhere. They went nowhere. So we changed our name, and we already had a following, and we thought, okay, life's something. So we just went Real Life. That'll do. That'll do. And we did. There used to be Life magazine, and they had a logo, and we used to have Real and the Life magazine logo. We would have been sued, I think, if anyone.
Oh, gosh. Wow.
But that's what we used as our name. So that's how it became Real Life.
Nice. But at which point, you know, did you think that, okay, when Send Me an Angel came out, it became a massive hit worldwide. What was going through your mind at that time, you know? I remember one of the interviews we had, like, when you were in my studio years ago, I actually asked you, you know, if you weren't a musician, you know, what would you be, you know?
Did I say
and I still remember that thing.
Did I say archaeologist? What did I say?
I think you said taxi driver, you know.
I was a taxi driver. When Real Life were playing gigs, I was driving taxis. Because I think we got about $25 or $50 for a show, and the sound guy took everything. It was important to have a good sound, so the sound guy took everything.
Yeah. But I mean, at the end of the day, you have to make ends meet, and you know, you have to do whatever you can to just get the music out, and that's very important for musicians. Oh, and you did that, man.
Yeah, we did. But even when Send Me an Angel first came out in Australia, Australia was a very rock and roll, you know, macho kind of place with, I don't know, you know, bands like Rose Tattoo and Midnight Oil and, you know, tough rock bands.
Yeah.
And Real Life were a new wave band, you know.
Yes.
We wore funny clothes and makeup, and we were a bit androgynous. And that didn't go down well in some of the Australian places we played. You know, it was very rough. We opened for Midnight Oil and Rose Tattoo. And in those venues, you know, for Rose Tattoo, you're playing to a bunch of bikies who are standing at you looking like they're going to kill you, you know? So, and even in Australia, our record company and the press people said, oh, yeah, Send Me an Angel's a not bad song. It might get into the top 20. You know, we had no idea about America. And one day, our tour manager said, guys, I've just heard this news from America in the Billboard chart magazine.
Yeah.
Send Me an Angel is 198 on the Billboard Hot 200.
Amazing.
That's number 198. We're going, it's not going to go any further than that.
Okay.
So, and then even a year later, it became a big hit song in Germany. So it took like a year to go from a hit in Australia and America to then going to Germany and Europe to be a big hit as well. So
while you were doing all that, right, while the music was actually spreading out, what were the things that were going on in the band? Were you thinking of creating more music, or you just wanted to start gigging and touring and, you know, without all the social media stuff 10, 20, 30 years ago, right? You know, we were just thinking of just gigging or?
No, well, we were working about 7 nights a week. Yeah, that's why we built out. You built a following. We had a really great live scene, pretty much everywhere in Australia. We call it the pub scene. And when we first started out, we had what we called rent a crowd. We'd beg all of our friends to come and see us. You know, there'd be 30 people or something there.
Okay.
And there'd be some people that we didn't invite, and we had to make people like us. We had to be good. We had to build that crowd. So then, next best thing was to try to get a job supporting one of the bigger bands, whether we supported INXS and Ice House and, like I said, Midnight Oil and Rose Tattoo, The Church. We supported all those bands, and we stole at least, you know, 10 or 15 people off every that audience every time we played. So we would have our own solo gig on a Tuesday night in the middle of winter in Melbourne, and we'd have 1,000 people there because we'd built up the following. Because when we'd open for these bands, they were impressed. They'd never seen anything quite like it. So we built that following, and we were working towards a record contract and a career. So when Semi and Angel came out, we hadn't recorded an album. We just recorded that as a single. Then we recorded another single that did terribly, but I love the song, Open-Hearted. And then Catch Me on Falling came out, and we were still recording the album when Catch Me on Falling came out and became a hit as well. So it wasn't that well coordinated. And Send Me an Angel in America became a hit sort of by accident, because there was a famous radio station over there called K-Rock in Los Angeles, which was famous for making The Cure and Depeche Mode, everyone famous, all that sort of new wave music first got into America via K-Rock in Los Angeles. And there was a radio station in Sydney that had brought out the program director from K-Rock all the way from Los Angeles to Sydney to try to make their station sound more like K-Rock. And he was here. His name was Rick Carroll. And Send Me an Angel was a hit at that radio station in Sydney, and he loved that, and he took it back to America and started playing it on K-Rock before we even had a record deal. And we thought, oh, no.
Oh.
We're on American radio, and we're getting the best play, and we haven't got a record deal. Yeah, quick. We'll sign anything. We'll sign something.
So really? You just wanted to sign... Oh, okay. Well,
you had to, because if you're getting airplay in America, people can't go and buy the record. You're not going to get a second chance. You get one chance. So we had to sign... Well, our manager knew the record company, but it actually was a country and western label, which was not...
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
But anyway, it still did well over there. Nothing has ever been that coordinated with us. It's always been a bit of a mess, a bit of good luck, a lot of chaos. So, you know, but it all worked out. You look back and go, would I change anything? And probably not. You know, it's all okay.
Good. Okay, we have a David Steery from real life, live from Melbourne, Australia. We're going to take a break. We'll be back with more from this legend in music. Stay tuned.